This is KLEAN Radio.
Welcome everybody out there listening to KLEAN Radio, and I'm going to give one more shout out to Rand DeWitt, who made the most amazing promo I have ever heard. Welcome everybody out there listening to KLEAN Radio. Our hashtag tonight is Hope Starts Here. That's hashtag Hope Starts Here. Go to facebook.com/KLEAN Radio. One of the things we're posting tonight are eight fun things that I never knew I could do sober. We have an amazing show for you tonight. First, quickly, I want to say a little homage to James Gardner, who passed away. He was in an amazing movie, probably one of the best movies about alcoholism, which was My Name is Bill W. He actually executive produced a number. And I think what's amazing about that movie, much like this show that we try to do, is that we try to bring the message out there of hope, and for people that really don't know what the 12 steps are, for people that don't know what treatment are, how to get there. And so James Gardner, when I was 12 or 11 or 9 or 8, whenever I watched that movie, I mean, obviously I watched every other amazing thing he was in, but that movie really helped shape my life. It's My Name is Bill W. With James Woods and James Gardner. It was amazing, so thank you, James Gardner. And if you just tuned in, you are listening to KLEAN Radio. We have a great show for you tonight. The hashtag tonight, it is Hope Starts Here. Give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. Quickly, when I was younger, when I was 18 years old, I needed help. And my parents didn't know where to go. My parents didn't know what to do. I posted this story on KLEANradio.com on a blog about the guy named Izzy that helped my parents out. And what he did for them saved my life. And he became my family's advocate. And he took them through. He found them the right rehab that I needed to go to. He fought for us. He told them how the insurance companies work. And he did all these amazing things. And he stayed with my family. It wasn't like just I went to rehab and Izzy left. He actually stayed with my family for about 4 years. And I don't mean in their house. He just would always call, always check up on me. And it's a big reason why we do what we do, is paying back for what people like Izzy did for my family. And I really wanted to make this show tonight about people out there, you know, and the reason I wanted to do the Hope Starts Here is because there are so many people out there, so many teenagers, so many young adults, so many people, but I really wanted to focus that tonight because I don't think parents always know what to do. I don't think loved ones always know what to do. And if you're struggling out there, tonight's the show. Tonight's the show. I want you to call us up with any questions that you might have. We have two amazing guests in studio tonight. One is a man I've known for a long time. He's the intake director at KLEAN Treatment Center, and his name is Joe Perot.
Hello.
Welcome to KLEAN Radio, Joe. Welcome back, of course.
Thank you.
And I'm going to tell a great story that happened with Joe and I, and we have two Joes tonight. But Joe Perot, one time he asked me if I could pick up a client from the airport, and the client didn't exactly get into my car, and I didn't know what to do. I'm freaking out, they're freaking out, and I call you on the phone. You go, just let me talk to them for a couple seconds. You speak to them on the phone for about 15 seconds. They got right in my car. And Joe Perot, you are the champ.
Don't ask me what I said.
I'm not. And also, for the first time on KLEAN Radio is a woman by the name of Jo Bainbridge. She works for Destinations in Recovery.
Hi, Judith.
You got to come a little closer to the mic.
Hi, Judith. There you go. I'm close enough.
You're close enough. You're plenty close. And why don't you tell us a little bit about Destinations in Recovery and what you do there?
I'm the director of, well, first of all, thanks for having me on. This is lovely. And lovely story about Joe. I imagine you were terribly persuasive. So, I'm the director of clinical outreach at Destinations to Recovery. We work exclusively with adolescents. So we've got two residential houses in Topanga Canyon and an IOP in Woodland Hills. And, we work with kids who have issues with mental health and addiction issues. And it's a really underserved population. And it's super rewarding, because I think if you can get people, young people, when they're young like that, you spare so much, the families so much agony, and themselves so much agony. So it's brilliant to be there.
And I want to give you some statistics. In the past year, use of various drugs by 12th graders, 37% have said they used pot, 8% synthetic marijuana, 8% Adderall, 6% Vicodin, 5% cough medicine, 5% tranquilizers, 5% hallucinogens, sedatives, 5%. oxycodone 4%. And this is if the numbers are correct. I'm guessing on the lower side. Yeah. Mm. And that is a terrifying statistic. You have parents out there that are, you know, have teenagers, have kids, and this is what's going on. The kid goes to school. We don't know what's going to happen after. Joe, you work with teens.
Mm-hmm. And their families, right?
And their families.
Right, absolutely.
You're getting kids that are 12, 13, 14 years old.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and some of whom may have overdosed, or, you know, their life may really have been on the line so far. And really what you're looking at when you invite the family in to get treatment is, you know, this hasn't happened in a vacuum. So we kind of, like, look at the family system, what's going on there, and very often you're looking at a system of denial that's been in place, not just in, you know, several generations as well. So the parents often end up going into treatment as well.
So if you just tuned in, you're listening to KLEAN Radio. That's Joe Bainbridge from Destinations in Recovery, Joe Perot from KLEAN Treatment Centers. And the show tonight, give us a call, is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. I also thought about this because years ago, obviously, we all remember the song Runaway Train. But, you know, that was in the 90s. And that was a song about teenage runaways. It was a song about teenagers that have run away, were on drugs, were, you know, and all over the world, they posted these videos of the kids that were from that region. And kids were found. And I often hear people say, you know, it's this thought that the parents don't care, you know. And while that might be a case in a certain, for the most part, parents care. Parents are worried. I just don't think, Joe, they know what to do.
They don't know what to do. Yeah.
And it's easy to say they don't care. That's the easy answer. The thing is, I don't think people know how to get help. I really don't. Insurance companies don't let people know. They don't want to let people know that you have coverage, Joe.
Right, right.
And why don't you talk about that a little bit, that people out there do have access to health insurance.
Well,
or if they do. Yeah.
Well, a lot of people do, and they don't even realize that they do. I mean, if your kids are on your health insurance plan, there's a very good chance that there's coverage for substance abuse treatment. A lot of people don't even realize that it's there because it's not something that they really market.
Right.
Don't forget you've got substance abuse treatment coverage. So it's something that, you know, if you've got somebody that's in need in your family, whether they're an adolescent or an adult, call your insurance company, you know, or call us.
Yeah.
Give us a call. We'll check into your insurance for you.
Joe, you want to?
Yeah. I think for a lot of parents as well, that they can be in a state of confusion about what is actually happening, and sort of the level of denial is so high, and they can be actually confused about sort of where did this come from, what's our part, and then so the blame can often be, you know, sometimes focused upon the young person that's coming into treatment. But also I absolutely agree with you, parents do care, and if there is any blame, whatever, it's just protective. It's just because the parents are like, we really don't want this to be happening. How can we fix it? What can we do? They're out of ideas at that point.
And so you said you actually treat parents sometimes. You obviously, at your facility, you don't treat parents, but you find that parents go in for treatment too?
Well, we don't treat parents, but we do work with the family.
Yeah.
I'm also a clinician still getting my hours. And we work with the parents. And then if they need to go into sort of more extensive, we don't look after adults, then we would sort of refer them out elsewhere. But really working with the family, so to make sure that the young person doesn't go back into a family that's going to enable or support the addiction or the alcoholism, that's really critical. And it's you're really dismantling a lot of old stuff.
And I'm sure you hear a lot of people say, and I used to hear this a lot with young people, it's a phase. You know, they're going to grow out of this. You know, whatever major drugs they're on, it's just a phase at 13.
Yeah, and clearly, you know, if someone, it's a self-diagnosed disease, right? But also it's clear if someone's, you know, been hospitalized or been put on a hold or had overdoses, this is not just a rite of passage. And what really, what Destinations to Recovery promotes is we promote sobriety throughout your teenage years. It doesn't have to be this sort of rite of passage where you have to go and get messed up and put your life on the line. And we go into schools and we carry that message to sort of reassure and promote to young people that it's all right to be sober. It's cool. It's hip. It's sexy. It's normal, you know.
So you lie. No, I'm joking.
It's any use under the age of 21 is abuse. Huh.
Okay.
That's the truth,
right?
You know. Any use at all is abuse and can be problematic.
And do you think parents, I mean, parents, I would imagine, have a hard time these days talking about certain things because they themselves have done it. Mm. You know, you have a generation of parents that probably, you know, experimented with one drug or another, and they don't understand that just because they did it, it doesn't mean that's all right for their kid to do it, because the drugs are much stronger today. Yeah. They're much more dangerous. Mm-hmm. Pot's way more potent than it was when any parent really did it in their generation.
And they're doing it heroin in high school like we smoked pot when we were in high school. Uh-huh. I mean, it's a whole different game now than it was then.
Mm-hmm. And if you just tuned in, you are listening to KLEAN Radio. We're in the studio tonight with Joe Bainbridge from Destinations in Recovery. Joe Perot from KLEAN Treatment Centers. Our hashtag tonight is Hope Starts Here. Give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. The reason I wanted to talk about this tonight was because from my own experience, for the person that helped my family out, you know, we sometimes don't realize that so many people don't know where to go to help. And somebody had asked me this before. Maybe you both could answer this. It seemed like in the 80s and in the 90s, 12-step groups advertised more. There was much more advertisement, whether it was DARE was just starting out, whether MAD was in its infancy. But it did seem like there was a lot more public service announcements. There was much more awareness for drug addiction. Or is, am I just getting old and I don't watch TV anymore?
Maybe, Joe, you can speak to that. I wasn't actually...
She wasn't in this country.
I don't have a frame of reference for that. So, Joe, maybe you can...
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that question. I think that, there was, you know, there was DARE and there was the Just Say No to Drugs. You know, that was kind of a big deal.
Huge campaign.
Yeah.
Not that it was helpful, but it was a campaign.
Exactly, yeah. I think drugs and alcohol abuse and addiction is in the media now more than it ever has been, you know.
So the question is, I want to ask you both, you know, a lot of times when parents are in trouble or they're not to blame, right? This isn't a blame game. And I think a lot of people need to understand that whatever happened. You're not going to call up and say, I need help for my child. And somebody's going to go, or my loved one, and somebody's going to go, what did you do? This is your fault. And I think a lot of people do have a big fear with that because they think it's, you know, it's resemblance on something they did wrong if their child is. Do you get that a lot? Either of you?
Yeah, I think if you're looking at, sometimes, you know, the experience can be that young people have seen their parents sort of using or drinking or using, and they just say, well, why can't I do it like they do it? And they don't realize that it's sort of like a different, that they're children effectively. But they feel like they've been given the green light to go ahead and do it. Now, sometimes that can make it, you know, a parent sort of angry. They might not be willing to sort of look at their own lifestyle. But then what usually happens is that they see that they need to get well too. So then that becomes kind of like a state of forgiveness and acceptance, and sort of that's how the growth sort of begins. What's your experience, Joe?
I just see people when they're, you know, like family, when families call about usually their adult children, it seems like they've got a little concern about judgment. There's a little bit of shame involved. But for the most part, they're just calling and they're in crisis and they need help. And, you know, and they're lucky to hear, or, you know, they're lucky and grateful to have somebody on the other end that'll listen to them, you know.
And if you just tuned in, you are listening to KLEAN Radio. Let's go to Ryan calling from Vancouver, Washington. Welcome to KLEAN Radio, Ryan.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Thanks for calling.
Yeah, so I just had a question. If you guys had any recommendations for, like, facilities or treatment programs for actually getting off Suboxone that I was put on when I got out of service for opiate addiction. I've been having trouble getting off it.
And you're not alone, Ryan. And I think Joe Perot could actually answer that question very well.
Ryan, I mean, that's something that we absolutely could do at KLEAN Treatment Center. We've got two residential programs, one in Washington, another one in West Hollywood. And we see a lot of people that, you know, they've got an opiate issue, and then they, for one reason or another, they go on Suboxone, and then they realize at some point, oh, wow, now I've got to get off this.
Right.
I'm dependent on this. And
right.
it's really difficult to do it on your own. So you need a medical detox to go through it, you know, and you need that support and that structure around you. And it's really beneficial to do that.
But you've seen people successfully transition off of it.
Absolutely.
A lot of the vets, too, that I know that are on it, you know, they talk about taping you down to a level where you get off, but nobody I know has gotten off of it. I mean, plenty of tribe.
Yeah, you know, Ryan, you know, it's an interesting thing you're talking about because you're hanging out with people that are still doing it. But the thing is, like, let's say you were to go to a 12-step meeting after you got sober, you'd see a lot of people that have gotten off it. You're just with the ones that are still doing it. So your experience is in that. By the way, I want to thank you for your service.
Sure.
And here's the thing. We actually have, we have facilities, and this is what we want to do for you tonight, Ryan, because we want you to get help. And if you're interested in getting help, we'll help you tonight.
Yeah, I'll check it out.
And, you know, I'm going to put you on hold in a second, and I want you to, Rand will be on the other side of the line. And if your insurance covers, we're going to figure out a way. If you want, Ryan, you know, we're so appreciative of what you've done. And, Joe, this is a problem a lot of vets are having. You know, a lot of our veterans are coming home and, you know, whether it's pain meds, whether it's a whole slew of addictions that the government's really not ready to handle.
Right, right.
And, Ryan, I mean, I guess it would be, it's tough.
Yeah, it is.
How long has it been going on?
Oh, man, like 5 years now. 5 years. Since I've been on Suboxone, it's been about 5 years. I've tried to get off numerous times, but, you know, it's just, I could give you a million reasons why, but, you know, the main is just physical.
It's a major physical addiction.
It is.
Yeah.
So, Ryan, I'll tell you what. Again, I want to thank you for your service. Can you hold on?
Sure.
And Rand is going to get to you in a second. That's Ryan calling from Vancouver, Washington. If you just tuned in, you are listening to Clean Radio. And one of the things Ryan was calling about right now, Joe, is he's addicted to Suboxone. He's addicted to the drug that helps you get off of heroin and other drugs.
Right.
And it's like, I can imagine in his mind the isolating feeling of thinking, well, I'm addicted to this thing that I'm used. And here's a guy that fought, you know, that served our country, the unweakest of people. And there's this old myth sometimes about addiction, we're weak, you know, it's a weakness. Here's a guy that went to fight, that served our country. He's the strongest, yet he's got this.
Right, right.
And the reason I talk about that is because it's important, I think, that people know that sometimes, that addiction is not a weakness. It's not a moral issue. It's an addiction.
It's a disease.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I wanted you to talk about, let's talk a little bit about Suboxone. Let's talk about the dangers and, you know, the dangers, you know, I mentioned all these different things, Vicodin, Adderall, synthetic marijuana, tranquilizers, 12-year-old, you know, that 12th graders are using. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a tremendous study of these, even if they, you know, we're saying they're incorrect because it's probably more, even if they are correct, it's terrifying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's probably underreported.
Yeah.
Like you're saying as well. And it is the norm. And, you know, when we do go into schools and talk to parents, the parents, they're really, really hungry for ideas and solutions, and they want to know what can we do. We don't want this to, you know, to go any further. They're really, really concerned. They're really reaching out, and like you said, they don't often know where to go, which is why, you know, we do this program of going into places and saying we are here as a resource, whatever, even if your young person doesn't come and get treatment with us, we will help you and support you in any way we can.
What are some of the things that parents ask you?
Why us? I've tried everything, you know, that they list, that it's kind of, you know, like the list of, well, you know, we threw this at it, we went on holiday, or we tried to do this, and nothing seems to work. And I just, you know, sometimes I disclose my own personal story of being in recovery just to sort of give them that piece of empathy and just to hopefully model to them that, you know, recovery is a tangible thing and it's not just somebody lying under the bridge downtown with a needle sticking in their eyeball, although, of course, we feel for that person. But I just try and make it relatable to them because they come in there often in a state of shock and exhausted.
And so it's a hard question. It's why. You know, why is this happening? Because it doesn't matter. Addiction doesn't know socioeconomic. It doesn't know skin color. It doesn't know race or anything. It just knows, it knows addiction.
And you know, no one has really asked them before, how are you?
Right.
How are you doing? So I say, that's great. Like, we can figure the why out now. But right now, tell me where you're at. And that's when you just see this sort of melting and this, you know, thank you for listening. Thank you for not judging. Thank you for just, you know, welcoming us as we are.
Which is why the whole idea of having advocates is so important. It's family members, you know, people, you know, we've had some amazing guests on the show, like Rada Sputo, who's an interventionist, and why sometimes it's so important to, you know, to have people on your side. Because addiction is isolating for the addict, it's really isolating for the family too.
I read your article about this, about Izzy, your advocate.
Yes, Izzy.
It sounded like he couldn't have entered your family's life a moment too soon.
He, you know, I was 18 years old. I was in a different country. my parents didn't know, you know, right. Parents who are very smart people. But most people just don't really know addiction. It's not something they know. It's always something that happens for somebody else. Even if it's still somebody in your family, it's always the other, it's that somebody else.
Right.
And, you know, that's why a movie like that James Garner did, My Name is Bill W., why those things are so important, because it was a Hallmark Hall of Fame movie. I think it was on CBS when I was a kid. And in those days, 30 million people watched this movie. And it's extremely important. So give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. The hashtag tonight is Hope Starts Here. If you're driving around or you're listening from home and you're struggling, this is the night I want you to stop struggling. I want you to give us a call, and I want you to talk to Joe or Joe, because one Joe specializes with teens, one Joe specializes with adults, and you don't have, like, Joe, what you just said is amazing, and I love it, because what our parents, what we put our family members through, the hope, the despair, the isolation, it's embarrassing sometimes. If your kid is using drugs, and even though other kids are using drugs, who do you talk to? Who do you go to and say, I don't know what to do. I'm in trouble. My family's in trouble. And it could be a little bit embarrassing, but the worst thing you could do is not calling and saying, I need help. And that's why tonight, hope starts here. I want people out there to know there is hope. There was hope for me. There was somebody like Izzy in my life. And we all have in our lives. Everybody in this studio tonight is sober. I hope I didn't break your anonymities. I don't care if I did. No, is sober and has gone through this. And the thing is, we go through it ourselves in our own personal lives sometimes too. Yeah. But I got to tell you, tonight we have in studio two of the most caring individuals I've ever heard on phones. Joe Perot is one of the most caring individuals when it comes to talking to people. Because whatever reasons, you've been there, you get it. So don't be embarrassed. Don't be ashamed. Give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. Coming back from the break, because we're talking about, you know, hope starts here, I want to tell you some fun things that I learned that I did that I never thought in my wildest dreams I would ever do. I'm going to get some of them from Joe. I'm going to get some of those fun things from the other Joe, but I want to hear from the people out there. So give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. We're in the studio tonight with Joe Bainbridge from Destination Zone Recovery, Joe Perot from Clean Treatment Centers. And again, like I said, go to facebook.com/clean radio, post. I understand this is a really hard thing to talk about. And if you need to talk about this with us privately, private message us. I get this is one of the hardest things to talk about, is the people that are isolated out there and need hope. We'll be back in a couple seconds. Discussion continues on Clean Radio.
Are you or someone you care about addicted to drugs or alcohol? Addiction ruins lives and destroys families. Bring an end to the pain and suffering by calling Clean Treatment Centers. Clean has helped people from around the world break free by not only treating the addiction, but the underlying causes and providing vital aftercare so people can get clean and stay clean with no gimmicks and no false promises. If you need immediate assistance or just have questions, call Clean Treatment Centers for guidance. A much better life awaits.
Now back to Andrew Spanswick and Judah Friedman.
Welcome back to Clean Radio. As our social media question tonight was, some fun things you do sober. buddy, Totten, in studio, our social media guru.
Hey, how's it going?
Tell us what you got for us, buds.
Okay, so Angela posted being a good mom, a wife, owning her own car for the first time and her own house. She got a bachelor's degree.
She works in a career helping other addicts. Marie swam with stingrays for the first time. That's pretty awesome.
That's okay.
Right. And then Nick posted he went to a concert. He never thought he'd be able to go to a concert sober.
So, Nick, that's the same experience I had.
Right.
But that was one of my first things was going to a concert sober. I got sober. I was 22 years old. I'm sure Joe and Joe could both relate to this. Your first thought when you get sober is how can I go to a concert? If right. I'm, you know, there's booze.
I'll never have
you know,
again.
It's sort of, you know, everybody. But the great thing about going to a concert sober, and I went to Poison and Cinderella, okay?
Oh,
and
nice.
And this was post when they were big. And there were 20,000 people in Jones Beach. I gotta tell you, I don't remember much of the show, but I remember the next morning, you know, I knew where my car was after I got out of the concert. I gotta tell you, that was a spiritual experience. Because when you have alcoholism and you drive to a concert, the odds of you finding your car right away, slim to none, Joe. So that I agree with. Jumping out of a plane was number two for me because unlike the stingray thing, I guess that's my stingray and I'm scared of heights.
Right.
And number four, I'm going to skip number three for the beginning. Number four was being a part of society, which I think is, you know, it's for alcoholics and addicts. We really don't always want to be part of society. We pride ourselves on being a recluse.
We are professionally marginalized, aren't we? Bless us.
And the biggest reason is because, you know, it takes a lot to be part of society. And it's easier just sitting at home or sitting. So those, buddy, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Will see you next week.
Absolutely.
And if you just tuned in, you are listening to KLEAN Radio. So give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. Let's welcome back Joe Bainbridge from Destinations Recovery, Joe Perot from KLEAN Treatment Centers, but let's go to Lee, who's calling from Sherman Oaks. Welcome to KLEAN Radio, Lee.
Yeah, hello. How are you, sir?
Good. How are you?
Okay. I'll try to be succinct because it's a long 30-year story, but may I start?
Yes, go for it.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Our son started off, you know, working before he was 18, and I felt it was good for him.
Lee, if you could speak up a little bit.
Oh, our son started working before the age of 18, and he got hooked on drugs here in the, the late 1990s.
Right.
Even before that, when he was actually about 17, 18. Anyway, the point I'm stating is he tried various jobs, couldn't succeed because he had a high drug habit. We went to Cry Help and, different organizations over the years. I can't even remember the names of many of them, but they were all over the valley, if you will.
Right.
And nothing seemed to come out of it. And over the years, he learned to blame his parents in one respect, that we were either too tough, we never allowed him to go out and do things on his own, we were too protective, etc. I was the passive one, and my wife is very aggressive, the opposite of me. But the point is that he became involved many years ago, and he fell under Megan's Law. He was in his very early 20s, and he got involved with a young girl, underage.
Right.
So he fell in as Megan's Law, and wherever he goes, he's considered a predator, which we know is not true. He goes out with older ladies now, you know, not young people. He's afraid of being near children. Anyway, the point is, we don't know what to do because we had a discussion, and he doesn't think much of his future. He looks bleak to him.
Right. Is he still using drugs?
Apparently, yes. If it's not liquor, it goes to, the lighter ones, pot, whatever, and normal drugs that doctors prescribe. So he uses a combination.
Of painkillers and stuff, you mean?
Yeah, from what I know.
Yeah.
So right now we're at our wit's end. We told him to leave the house, you know.
Right.
He comes here for fortitude, and we often let him move in, and See, nothing seems to help, so we finally said, it's time to go, you know, and reluctantly he did, and he ended up living with some friends of his, female friends. So right now it's up in a state of flux. We told him we'd be willing to go with him again to get some sort of treatment, family unit, but it's very difficult and complex.
See, Lee, what I'm hearing, and I think Joe and Joe would probably agree with me, I'm hearing that there's even... Take your son out of the picture for a second. Even the way you said you're the passive one, your wife's the aggressive one, and all these things. The thing is, you guys need to go get help for yourselves. You and your wife need to find a 12-step meeting. I highly recommend Alan on. And you guys need to work on your stuff so that way you know how to deal with him. Drug addicts are extremely hard to deal with. We're not an easy lot. And we know how to make husbands, wives, sons, brothers take sides. We know how to isolate and do everything. And you guys need to get on the same wavelength, you and your wife. And I really think Al-Anon, something, even therapy, could be extremely beneficial for you and your wife because it's a unified front.
We tried Al-Anon years ago.
Okay.
We went through all the usual courses, right, if you will. And there's just so many. I can't even remember some of the names now.
Right.
But many, and in the end, he still felt that...
But it's not about him.
No, he felt that it's the parent, that we were directly or indirectly the responsible cause of what he's doing. At times, he's alluded to the fact maybe it's him, but other times it's us. So it's kind of like a merry-go-round.
Right, but here's the thing. You could get off the merry-go-round. You and your wife need to live a life. And I know that just rhymed, I'm sorry, but you and your wife need to live a life. And you guys need to take care of yourselves. And I'm speaking about this from personal experience of having seen programs like Al-Anon, Therapy, Codependence Anonymous, save families' lives. I've seen it. And it's most important. You have a long time to live, and I want you and your wife to be okay. And I want you and your wife to be happy. Joe, am I missing anything?
You got it.
Yeah.
Well, may I interject for one?
Yes.
He has been in a different... what do you call it, homes?
Yeah, treatment centers.
Treatment centers. And as soon as some of the individuals in the groups, you know, there's a close relationship there between mm-hmm. the people in their groups, as soon as they find out about the law, Megan's Law,
right,
and some of the managers, if you will, have revealed this to the other people, and everyone turns against him.
Right. That's going to be his... And Lee, thank you so much for the call. And that's going to be his cross to bear for the rest of his life. Joe, how many people do we meet that come in with horrific stories? Doesn't matter what it is. Jail, felonies. How is my life going to get better? And all of a sudden, you see him 1 month sober, 6 months sober, and something changed. Things get better.
You know, they'll never turn you away from the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous.
Yeah.
That's right. And
I would
definitely say, please go back to Al-Anon. Just because, you know, give it another shot.
And you could hear it. You could hear it in his...
Absolutely.
The unified, you know, front needs to be... That is so important.
Yeah, and the wellness starts with self.
Yeah.
And he can, you know, you can carry the message, but you can't carry the addict or the alcoholic. And so him and his wife, or him at least, has to start going back to meetings and sort of focus on himself.
And Joe Pro, I actually want to ask you a question, because you didn't get into this. This was sort of fluky, right? I mean, you're a former, you know, you had a different life, even in sobriety, and something happened. What changed? What was the passion that wanted you to get into helping people?
I think it was.
Should I get back to you on that? No.
You know, I've always liked helping people in one way or another. You know, I used to be in. I've done 100 different things, but one of the things I used to do was fitness training, and I liked the feeling of working with people and helping them achieve results. And when I got in recovery and started getting a little bit of time and started sponsoring guys, that's when I started thinking, wow, I would really like to work in recovery, because there's so much, you get so much recovery out of working in recovery, if that makes sense.
Yes.
You know?
What about you, Joe?
In terms of getting into sort of into the work, you know, well, I was really still out there. You know, I worked and lived in Tokyo for 8 years before I moved to LA in 2010 to do my program. And I worked as a TV reporter on a travel show, and it was brilliant. It was a lovely life, but something was really missing. It was a bit superficial. And so I knew that I wanted, I'd always loved helping people, I'd always worked well with people, and I volunteered on a crisis line. And just the intensity of it, being able to not know what's coming at you next, but also just being able to hear the relief in people's voices, that really spoke to me. And that's when I thought, yep, I can do this. This is what I'd like to do.
And if you just tuned in, you are listening to Clean Radio. That's Joe Bainbridge from Destinations Recovery. That's Joe Perot. I like the two Joes. And
Joe squared.
There you guys go. You guys. And so give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. One of the things I think that's important to also talk about, because I'm sure both of you guys get this question, especially with teenagers, especially we get it all the time, is what are you going to do after? So, and I think outpatient, I think... you know, intensive outpatient programs are extremely important. And it's not just this process of, oh, you go to rehab and then we're done.
Correct. Well, definitely Destinations to Recovery, it's sort of inbuilt. It's sort of assumed that if it's, you know, you're not going to continue with us, then you are going to continue elsewhere, because it's a lifelong process. Right. And certainly all our clinicians doing that, that's sort of built in that, you know, this is just the seeds, but this is the foundation. And this is going to be something you're going to be working on daily, like on a lifelong basis, not in an overwhelming kind of way,
right,
but just to sort of give it that longevity. And also just to give them the breathing space to understand they don't have to get it all like right now. It doesn't have to all be fixed by, you know, in 2 weeks' time.
And that this, Joe, this is a lifelong process.
Right. I mean, this is something that we work on with clients as well, is that, you know, you may be in treatment for 30, 60, or 90 days, but it doesn't stop there. What we try to instill in people is to get involved and to get involved in, excuse me, in community. And there's a big recovery community out there, almost anywhere you go. And the key to remaining, you know, to staying clean is maintaining your recovery, and you have to maintain it. It's like any other illness. Maybe you have to, you know, you have to do something to keep it sort of at bay,
right?
You know, and staying connected to a recovery community and a support community is really important. And that's why we have such a great alumni program at Clean, because we want to keep people connected. And these guys, you know, they make friendships that could be lifelong friendships, and they help each other in recovery.
And there's a big reason I wanted Joe in tonight, Joe Bainbridge, is because I checked out Destinations in Recovery, the way you treat adolescents. I was floored by how good your program was.
I'm so glad. Thank you.
And one of the things I love about Clean is that we, like Joe just said, is that we don't give up on the client. You know, clients are with us, you know, through outpatient programs, through alumni programs. And it's really important, because that was my biggest thing my parents always like wanted to know is what's next. What's after? So my kid's going to be safe for 30 days. He's going to be safe for 60 days. But what about, so I have a 60-day reprieve. What happens on day 61?
They always ask that question.
Yeah. And it's such a good question. Yeah. And one of the things I love about both of you, but what we do here, is that we're like, stay with us for as long as you need. Stay, you know, outpatient programs, alumni programs. We're not letting you go till you're good to go if you want to be with us. Mm-hmm. And So give us a call. The number's 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. Let's go to John calling from Los Alamitos. John, welcome back to Clean Radio.
Oh, hi. Thank you. I talked to you 2 weeks ago. I have a son who's 21, and between the ages of 15 and 21, he's been in rehab 4.5 times. And, you know, he's still a drug addict.
Right.
And participating. And you folks recommended, and the problem we had talked about, that when we would spend 20 minutes on the phone with them or visit with them for 20 minutes, he would suck the life out of you. You know what I mean? And by the time you were through, and I think I called when...
Mackenzie Phillips was on.
Correct. Uh-huh. And anyway, you folks suggested that I go to Al-Anon. And I went to two, you know, since that, I've gone to two Al-Anon meetings. And I think it's important for parents, you know, people that are in my position, even if your son or your daughter doesn't want to get it together and go to recovery, that by going to Al-Anon, it helped me. I feel better now than I did 2 weeks ago when I called you. You know, you feel like you're not sitting in the boat alone. You're the only person. You have some people to bounce, you know, ideas off of. So I just want to thank you guys. And
I love that you've done that. And the reason, you could almost hear the difference too. You know, you could almost hear the difference from when you called 2 weeks ago and you wanted to just, you know, pull the hair out of your head. And it's almost like by going to your first meeting, no different than when somebody goes to the first AA meeting, they're surrendering. And in a sense, you're surrendering. You're saying, I don't know what to do with this kid.
Hey, John, I just want to say thank you for making this call, because there are other people out there listening that are resistant to going to Al-Anon and that are saying, oh, you know, it's not going to work for me. It works for other people. It doesn't work for me. But I really appreciate that you made this call, and somebody out there is going to hear you, and you may inspire some other people to get to an Al-Anon meeting, because it's really important.
I participated in meetings while he was in recovery, you know, the different times that he was. Well, he's not in recovery now, but it's still, I feel it's still important. I need to go to an Al-Anon. I got to take care of me and keep myself sane.
That's right.
So that I can, you know, still deal with my son and hope that when the time's right, he'll be cleaning up his act.
And you'll know what to do, when that happens. And that's the difference between the last caller, Lee, who's struggling, who doesn't know what to do. You know, who doesn't know what to do? He's still in that game. He's still in the system that the addict allows us to play, you know, that makes us play.
But what it is, it's we allow them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We allow people, some people, they aggravate us, but it's because we allow them to aggravate us. So I was allowing my son to do this to me.
Yeah.
So I want to thank you guys, and I look forward to listening to your show every Sunday.
John, anytime, call in.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. And if you just tuned in, that was John calling from Los Alamitos. And we're in studio tonight with Joe Bainbridge from Destinations in Recovery, Joe Perot from KLEAN Treatment Centers. One of the things I wanted to talk about, Joe, quickly with both of you, and I want to get back to this because I think it's extremely important. I think outpatient programs are extremely important. The whole point of the show tonight was talking about letting us be your advocate. And I found treatment one time, actually. I was in an outpatient program in New York, and it didn't work. It wasn't working. My mother was begging them, please, he needs rehab. He doesn't need an outpatient, right? She's like, doesn't that come after? But the way the insurance companies worked was I had to mess up. I had to almost die in outpatient before I could actually get to the rehab. So gratefully, my mother, you know, stayed on it, and they put me in a rehab, and then afterwards I went to an outpatient. I just want to talk quickly about how important that is, the continuity, you know, that you go from rehab to outpatient, why that's so important.
Yeah, I mean, it's not a step down, really. I think it's on a continuum, isn't it? You know, and I think what works with us is that the young people are already so familiar with us. You know, there's that kind of like family environment, so that when they go into the outpatient, they crave that community that we've all been spoken to and that Joe just spoke to as well. So they've got a sense of belonging already. And I think that's all that any addict of any age or any socioeconomic group, I think that's just what they're craving, is that fellowship in that community.
Because that is what happens in outpatient, right? There is a fellowship.
Absolutely. Right. And it's a transition. You know, you've got a little bit more freedom now, you're a little bit less structured, and you can go to this outpatient program where you get to see a lot of the people that they're already part of your community. And you get to continue doing that work. And it's not intense as it is in residential, but you get to stay connected, you know, and that's really important. I mean, you're right. Going to outpatient first, you know, if you have to, you have to, but it should be the other way around.
Right.
Insurance companies don't really like.
And what's amazing is even my mother knew that.
Yeah.
She knew there was something bizarrely reverse about me going to the outpatient program and then going to the rehab. But, you know, going to an outpatient afterwards, I think it's important. And the reason the whole reason I wanted to do the show tonight about hope starts here, that's our hashtag, is that people don't know their benefits. You know, this isn't just about us. There are people that are driving around all over Portland. There are people all over the world, everybody listening to the show going, I don't know if I'm eligible to get help. And sometimes they need somebody fighting for them saying, you know what, you are eligible. You know, you can go to rehab. You can go to outpatient program if you need one. And it's for people like John who called. I mean, who had known a little bit about Al-Anon. But it's bringing awareness to these things that just because we're in the circle, mm-hmm. not everybody always knows about.
Right, right.
It should be easy, shouldn't it? It sounds like you guys have got the whole sort of welcoming intake thing down to a fine art. It should just be a simple phone call, reach out. You know, you're dealing with parents and with adults when they're at their most tired and vulnerable. It shouldn't have to be that challenging.
Do you think, again, part of it's not only challenging, there's fear.
Of course,
you know, this is the scariest thing in the world is, I love that, you know, John, who just called from Los Alamitos, because every time I hear a guy share that he goes to an Al-Anon meeting, I get the chills because it's not easy. You have this image in your head, and we all have these images in our head. And even for, you know, 12-step meetings, it's the homeless guy, you know, it's all people of society going to these meetings. And it's pretty cool, and it gives family members an oasis, which I think is extremely important. So if you just tuned in, you are listening to Clean Radio. That's Joe Bainbridge we have in studio tonight from Destinations in Recovery. It's an adolescent treatment center. I think it's remarkable. They're really lucky to have you because parents out there have you as an advocate.
Absolutely, and I love to talk to parents. I'd love for some parents to call, actually, or for some young people to call if they've got the time tonight. But I genuinely adore what I'm doing. And I think what they speak to is just that sense of relief of finally someone is listening. Finally someone is listening to us.
Andrew, do you get that a lot too? I mean...
I do. Parents, spouses, loved ones, you know, calling for, you know, their the person that really care about that's in need. It doesn't have to be that difficult, and it doesn't have to be such a scary process. Because when you make that call, you take that step, and then you get somebody on the other end that just kind of calmly and softly walks you through it, and we find out what we can do for you. We give you some options, and then we take some action.
And it's that simple, and it's also extremely scary at the same time. But the thing is, you're walking through the process with them. Mm-hmm. You know, you're with the family. You know, this isn't just they're dropped off. Okay, we'll see you guys in 30 or 60 or, you know, we're with you.
Right. Right. It's a collaboration, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right.
And I think it has to be. And I think there's a lot of peace to that. You know, there's a lot of peace to knowing that that you're not alone in the process. And I don't know if enough people, you know, it's... If you're terrified tonight, if you're alone tonight, if you're isolating tonight, and addiction has got you or got somebody in your family, you know, you're not alone. You just got to make the first call, and that number is 888-601-6040. That's 888-601-6040. One of the reasons, and I wrote a blog, and it's on Facebook.com, it's on cleanradio.com, was about that guy that helped save my life, the guy Izzy that was my family's advocate. And because my family didn't know from Adam. They didn't know from Adam. They're from Brooklyn. They had no idea of what this stuff was. And there are so many people out there that don't know what this stuff was. And there's sometimes you find the wrong people to trust. I'm grateful they found the right people to trust. But there are two people in studio tonight, Joe Bainbridge from Destinations Recovery, who I trust, and Joe Perot from Clean Treatment Centers, who I trust. And one of the reasons I wanted to talk a little bit about, again, about the outpatient part of it was because I know when you're young, especially, the biggest fears my family had was, what are you going to do with him after? He's going to go away to rehab for 30 days. He's going to go to Arizona. We're going to send him somewhere, that, you know, as long as there's an airline in between, an airplane in between. What's going to be after?
You know, another thing that's important is that the family work continues,
yeah. mm-hmm.
right? So we're not just sort of abandoning that process either. That's going to continue. So we're not letting go, yeah. right? So that really helps allay, you know, the parents' fears. And I think John encapsulated it beautifully. He said something very simple just about his Al-Anon experiences, that you're not in the boat alone. And that continues beyond the sort of leaving the residential as well. You're not in the boat alone. Still, we still got you. It's okay. And that's also them learning to trust that, you know, to reach out to help and to learn and to develop that muscle to reach out for help as well, you know, and to continue to rely upon, you know, professionals that can support them and care for them genuinely.
How do people find Destinations in Recovery?
They can go to, look online, www.destinationstorecovery.com. All the info is there, and I'd love to hear from anybody that needs any help.
And I'd be very remiss if I didn't take this last phone call. Todd, just let us know how you're doing in Salem, Oregon, Todd.
Hi, Judah. Hi, Joe.
Hey, Todd. Todd is a loyal listener to the show. He's calling from the mental, what's the name of the hospital again?
Oregon State Hospital, where they film One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
And we are on Todd's treatment plan that he gets to listen and call.
Oh, nice.
Fantastic. Thank you for calling, Todd.
I'm trying to really, one of the things I got into after becoming clean and sober is mindfulness. And that helps me a lot. And I got bipolar when I was 22 years old, and I had to go into a drug and alcohol facility. But I really didn't get diagnosed. They really didn't know what to do with me, and they kind of wanted to put me in a halfway house, but I didn't want to believe that I was really that sick.
And Todd, how's school?
School is going great. I got ton of manuscript, polishing it.
So that's amazing. You've taken the situation and you've made the best of it, Todd. And I got to give you, are you having fun?
Yeah, I'm gonna major in drug and alcohol treatment counseling. I got a bunch of drug and alcohol counselors that are certified. They're gonna guide me along here.
So you're actually saying a couple of my fun things in sobriety. One of them is being employed.
Okay. Yeah, I do.
Continuously.
Yeah, they have a really good voc rehab here.
Yeah,
do a lot of that.
You've essentially said it all, Todd. And you're gonna have to travel, which is one of my things that I skipped. You're gonna have to travel because you're gonna be working. You're gonna have to travel to your job, Todd. And
I really liked that that last guest, Ty. Yeah. She was really awesome. I really liked the way she spoke.
He's talking about Ty Babylonia, the famous U.S. figure skater. And you're going to say next week when you call in again that you loved our last two guests as much.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. These are awesome.
Of course you are, Todd.
And, yeah. No pressure.
Yeah, Todd, I mean, I got to tell you,
say bird?
You could say bird. And we will talk to you. I have no idea what he's saying, but I will
talk. Isn't that a girl in England or whatever?
You never know, Todd. I will talk to you later.
Okay, bye.
It can be now. Yeah. You're fine. Let's do it.
And that's Todd.
Okay, Todd.
And, you know, one of the things I love about that is he offers hope. And there are a lot of people out there that no matter what the dire situation is, if you're going through it tonight, give us a call. The number is 800. The number is 800. I will get that number in a second. Give the number, Joe.
888-601-6040.
Yeah, that's 888-601-6040. That's Joe Bangers from Destinations in Recovery. Joe Pearl from Clean Treatment Centers. Go to facebook.com/clean radio. Post after the show. We constantly get in touch with people. We understand this is one of the hardest things in the world people could ever talk about is how to get help and addiction. Private message us. We will get in touch with you as soon as possible. I want to thank Joe Perot again. I want to thank Joe Bainbridge. I want to thank everybody on Facebook that follows us, that likes us, that listens to us. I want to thank Rand DeWitt, Patrick Kennedy, Buddy Totten, the guy behind the board that I got to get your name by next week, brother. And and the discussion continues at cleanradio.com. I want to get better.
Are you or someone you care about addicted to drugs or alcohol? Addiction ruins lives and destroys families. Bring an end to the pain and suffering by calling Clean Treatment Centers. Clean has helped people from around the world break free by not only treating the addiction, but the underlying causes and providing vital aftercare so people can get clean and stay clean with no gimmicks and no false promises. If you need immediate assistance or just have questions, call Clean Treatment Centers for guidance. A much better life awaits.